So far in the course, we have discussed a number of circuits using the MOS transistor, and we have built up from basic single transistor circuits, single stage single transistor circuits, to circuits that use multiple transistors, and finally we have come to the op-amp. Okay. Now in our MOS is not the only device available. It is the most popular device today, but before there was another variety of transistor that was available, which was the bipolar junction transistor. I think you have studied this in the solid state devices course, right? Now it turns out that bipolar transistors cannot be made as small, and as you cannot pack circuits as densely as MOS. So that's why, especially for digital circuits, having MOS is a big advantage, and now even analog circuits are made mostly with MOS transistors. But there are some advantages to using bipolar transistors. In certain contexts, they'll have less noise. They can also reach higher frequencies and so on. So it is important to learn the differences between them and how to make circuits using bipolar transistors. And because we, in this course, do everything based on the model, we do the same thing for the MOS transistor also. So it is not that difficult to understand bipolar transistor circuits once you understand MOS once. Okay, the model turns out to be more or less similar, and everything that we learned earlier, like using the large signal models to calculate the operating point, small signal models for all the incremental stuff, that holds here. And because of that approach, you should be able to translate any MOS transistor circuit also into bipolar transistor circuit. Okay. Now the two devices are not exactly the same, so there will be some restrictions. There are some things you can do with bipolar and not with MOS, and vice versa. Okay. So now let's start looking at the bipolar transistor. In case of MOS transistor, we had two polarities, two types of transistors, N and P MOS, and the distinction between them was in the free carrier that is used for conducting the current, that conducts the current. Okay, the two devices were actually the same as each other, except for a polarity reversal of voltages and currents. Okay, now exactly similar to that, we have also two varieties of bipolar transistors, depending on the minority carriers injected into the base. Okay, so first we'll look at the counterpart of the N MOS transistor. In an N MOS transistor, the current is primarily determined by VGS, and it's also influenced by VDS to some extent, and the current flows from drain to source. Okay, the junction transistor corresponding to this is denoted by a symbol, somewhat similar, and the terminal corresponding to the drain is the collector, the gate is the base, and the source is the emitter. Okay. And the current flows, the total current flows into the collector of the transistor. Okay, and this current is primarily determined by the base emitter voltage VBE. In that respect, it is similar to the MOS transistor. And the collector emitter voltage, which corresponds to the drain source voltage VDS, also has some influence on the current. Okay. Now, one key difference between the MOS and bipolar transistors is that the gate in a MOS transistor, it's a capacitor. So for DC, this current is zero, whereas that's not the case for a bipolar transistor. This base current is not zero. It is small, but not zero. Okay. So because of this, this emitter current is slightly different from the collector current. Okay. Whereas here, whatever goes into the drain comes out of the source, nothing goes into the gate. Here, comes out of the emitter is what goes into the collector plus what goes into the base. Okay, what goes into the base is very small but not zero. Okay, clearly using Kirchhoff's current law you see that IE is IC plus IB. Okay, I think all this you already know, but the important thing I am trying to point out is it is very similar to the MOS transistor. Okay, if you increase VGS, ID increases, if you increase VBE, IC will increase and so on. The manner in which they increase is different, the functional dependence is different, but qualitatively there is some similarity. And as far as the model is concerned, this collector current will be some saturation current times exponential of VBE by VT. Okay, this is actually an approximation, a number of approximations are involved, and this is true if this VCE is greater than a certain voltage VCE sat. Okay, so we'll see what that is, and you should compare this to the equation for the MOS transistor in saturation region, mu on Cox by 2 VGS minus VT squared. Okay, this is true when VGS is more than VT and VDS is greater than VGS minus VT. Okay, so the regimes are the same. You have a sufficiently large VDS, this is true, right? The current will be dependent only on VGS. So similarly here, if you have a sufficiently large VCE, which is given by this, then the current will be dependent only on VBE. Okay, so that's the reason that I am describing here with this equation. Now it is possible to write the bipolar transistor equations for all regions of operation, but we won't worry about them. We don't do that. Okay, in the MOS transistor case, I also wrote the explicit equation explicitly for the triode region, but here I won't do that. It's a little messy, and also, as far as analog circuits are concerned, there is no use for that region when VCE is very small. Whereas in a MOS transistor, when VDS is very small, it's not good for an amplifier. But we saw that you can make a resistor out of that one. Okay, so in case of bipolar transistor, that region is not very useful. Okay, and this IB is the collector current divided by some constant beta, and this beta is the current gain of the bipolar transistor. Okay, and this beta will be a large number. I mean, again, this very much depends on the type of transistor. It could even be as low as 10, but typically you can take it to be a few hundreds. Okay, and sometimes when we want to crudely calculate something, especially when doing operating point calculations and so on, we could even assume beta to be infinity, in which case it is similar to a MOS transistor, there is no base current. It just makes the calculation easier. Okay, so after that you can insert the correct value of beta and see what changes it induces. Okay, any questions? Now we know that this is not quite the characteristic of the MOS transistor. It does have some dependence on the drain source voltage, which is given by 1 plus lambda in VDS multiplying the current otherwise. And a similar thing happens here. Somehow, I mean, conventionally this constant is not called lambda but 1 over VA. Okay, the 1 over VA corresponds to lambda here. Okay, so this exponential dependence on VBE is also multiplied by some linear dependence on VCE. Okay, and this VA is, you can expect to be a large number, so that there is a slight dependence on VCE. Okay, any questions? I mean, it's positive as far as this model is concerned. This itself, like I said, is an approximation. In reality, you will get a difference of two exponentials, but the other one you can neglect. Okay? But we just assume that it's positive and move on. So even if it's negative, this gives you a very small value and nothing is lost. The useful region is when substantial current is flowing through the transistor. Okay? So VB will be just like in a diode, it will be 0.6 or 0.7 volts. Because this is a very sharp dependence on VBE, right? So if you take VBE to, let's say, 200 millivolts, there will be some current, but that's so small that it's useless. It doesn't, I mean, other effects will come in and you can't use the transistor. Okay. As with the MOS, we can plot IC versus VBE, which will be just an exponential. Okay, and it will typically operate somewhere here, and because it's an exponential, even if the current changes by orders of magnitude, the change in VBE is quite small. Okay, the current changes by factor of 10, VBE changes by 60 millivolts or something. Okay, so it's not much. So that's one of the approximations. Just like with diode circuits, when we are doing hand analysis, if the transistor is on, we assume that VBE is some value, 0.7 volts or so. Okay, so that on value will be given to you. So this basically means that we don't know the value of IS, and even operating point calculations become very hard if we start with the exponential and substitute it into the equation. So the assumption simply says that the value of IS is magically adjusted so that whatever you calculate, the VBE comes out to be 0.7 volts. Okay, and this is similar to what you did for the diode, right? When you have an on diode, you assume that there is 0.7 volts across it. Okay. At 0 VBE, yeah, it is, it should be at 0 VBE and 0 VCE, it should be 0 current. Okay. This is a crude approximation. Okay. So, in fact, I won't, you shouldn't use this like on this side. I don't know, you have seen the actual equations of the bipolar transistor? That is, I mean, you will have an exponential of VBE and exponential of VBC also, right? So the difference, eventually when the terminal voltages are all 0, you will have 0 current, okay? But now I have excluded that exponential which is related to VBC altogether, okay? Because we will assume that VBC is negative and that part is negligible. And this, there will be some, there may be some minus 1 and so on, which I also have neglected. This is good enough because our focus is only to use it in this region. Okay. And if you plot IC versus VCE, you can see that it has no dependence on, I mean, if you exclude this part, there is no dependence on VCE, right? So the current will be constant with VCE. If you lower the value of VBE, current will also change, and if you lower it further, it will change, and if you lower it further, it will change, and so on. Okay? Because of the exponential dependence on VBE, for equal increments in VBE, the increments in IC will be unequal. It will become bigger and bigger and bigger. Okay? So this is VBE1, VBE2, VBE3, VBE4, and so on. Okay? So another qualitative difference between the bipolar and MOS transistor is that, I mean, MOS transistor also behaves this way, and then when you look at, so let's say this is VCE sat, okay, in case of MOS transistor, the limit on VDS is dependent on VGS. Here typically for our modeling purposes, we assume some fixed limit VCE sat, okay, and below that limit, in case of MOS transistor, you have this basically a parabola, right? And the curves for different values of VGS remain different. In this case, they all kind of merge into the same curve. And actually, there could even be a negative IC for 0 VCE. Okay? So this happens. But we won't, like I said, this region is not at all interesting for analog designers. Okay? So we won't even worry about that. Right? And most confusingly, this is the region that's called saturation region in a bipolar transistor. Okay, so I'll try to avoid this because we won't even go into this region, that's okay. So this region here, this is called the active region. Okay, so the region that corresponds to saturation region in a MOS transistor is called active region in a bipolar transistor. As long as you understand what it means, it should be fine. Meaning, as an amplifier, you want to operate where the current is dependent only on VBE or VGS and not very much dependent on VCE or VDS. Okay, so that's all that's there. That's fine. And I could also plot IB, but I mean IB is simply IC divided by beta. So it's the same, they are the same curves but scaled by beta. That's all. Why is beta a constant? It's, oh, that's, I think you have to go to the another course for this. So, it just so happens that it will be like that, right? I mean, you must have seen that the triangular carrier profile in the base, and IB is related to the slope of that, IC is related to the area, or the other way around. IC is related to the slope of that, IB is related to the area of that. And if you work out, if the base is very thin, this beta will be a large number, and the injected current into the collector will be much more than the current going into the base, and the ratio will be constant. Again, it's not exactly a constant. Beta will depend on the current, but over a region of currents, it can be assumed to be a constant for the prototype device. Okay, you have done this or no? Okay, so the beta is related to the base width and things like that, right? There must be some formula for beta that you must have seen, probably with WB in the denominator. Okay, so now our interest is to use the operate the set the operating point of the transistor here and then use it as an amplifier. Okay, you can, I mean, even without going through anything else, we had earlier, like long back, said that an ideal amplifying device should have some characteristic. What was that? Yeah, all these things. So that basically means that you should have a flat region, IC versus the output characteristics. The large signal output characteristics should be flat. Okay, and that's what we have. And also, again, we know that this is not the complete truth. If you include this factor, you will have the slope. Okay, this is fine. So there will be some slight dependence on VCE. It's not zero. Any questions? This value of VC is sat, it's some fixed number, and I mean depending on the transistor it could be as low as 0.2 volts but usually not below that. Okay, now in our case, just for simplicity, we'll assume that VC is sat is the same as VBE on, which is about 0.7 volts. Okay, so while doing operating point calculations, okay, just like for a diode, we assume that VBE on is 0.7 volts. What this means is, I mean, it's not that we assume a characteristic of this sort. We could do that also. Okay, if we do this, it becomes too much of an oversimplification. Okay, then the slope of IC versus VBE will become infinite here. okay. So that's like rather too crude. So that's not what we assume. We just, although it looks like that, what we are assuming is somehow the IS has been adjusted such that you get 0.7 volts for every transistor in any problem, okay. That's the idea. This is so that you don't have to calculate anything involving exponentials, okay. And this again should be familiar to you from solving diode problems, right. So this means that you actually calculate IC by assuming the transistor is on just like with the diode and then see if you come up with some contradiction or something, okay. And this VCSAT being VBE on, what it means is that, so here we will have 0.7 volts and here this should be greater than 0.7 volts, okay. So if I look at this voltage, what can you say? VBC. It should be negative, okay. VBC should be negative. So again, I think you know the structure of the bipolar transistor already. This is the, maybe I'll draw it in the same way. This is the collector, this is the base, this is the emitter. So you apply some VBE, it will be about 0.7 volts. So that means that this junction, the base emitter junction, is forward biased, right. If you have a PN junction and if you apply a positive voltage to P with respect to N, that is forward biased. And we are saying that VBC, this is less than 0. So that means that the collector base junction is reverse biased, okay. So again, this must be familiar from the devices course. This is how you use a bipolar transistor, okay. So you forward bias the base emitter junction, you reverse bias the collector base junction, right. What is this device? You just have P and N diode. This is a diode, right? Okay. So this is equivalent to right. Just connect it up. So this is the same as having two diodes, collector, base, emitter. Is this correct? Yeah? Why not? Huh? Yeah. So the difference between this is that difference between having two separate diodes and the actual bipolar transistor is that the width of this region is very, very small, okay. So that width is what gives you the transistor action. So you forward bias this, okay. So the current flows here, I mean the current flows here, but because this is so narrow, all of it gets fired into the collector and comes out as collector current. That's what gives you amplification, right. So if it was, if this region was very wide, all this current would simply go into the base and you would not get any amplifying action, okay. No, I didn't even do anything with the transistor yet. No, no, I mean I can define the voltages any which way I want, right. I mean I can take any two nodes and define a voltage between those two nodes. That doesn't say anything about the amplifier. I haven't even drawn the amplifier yet, okay. Yeah, but we will make the common emitter amplifier and also all other kinds of amplifier as well. So first, now you know the characteristic of the bipolar transistor, please find the small signal parameters, okay. And we have been using Y parameter models throughout, right. In fact, early on I said that I will start with Y parameter models because they are suitable for both bipolar and MOS transistor. So please find the Y parameter models, and obviously just like with the MOS, this emitter terminal is common to the controlling and control sides. Okay, so we have a 3-terminal 2-port where this is the base, this is the emitter, this is the collector. This is the port 1, this is port 2. So find Y11, Y12, Y21, Y22. Again, quite simple. All you have to do is to differentiate this. The key difference with the MOS is that in case of the MOS small signal model, port 1 has an open circuit. Here it will not be an open circuit anymore. That's all. Okay, because the base current is not 0, it won't be an open circuit. So, first the partial derivatives of IC, this will be IS by VT. Oh, by the way, I didn't define these terms. This VT is the thermal voltage, of course. Thermal voltage KT by Q. This VA, it's known as the early voltage. Okay. So we get this, and you easily see that this is just the actual collector current divided by the thermal voltage. Okay, this is like the small signal conductance of a diode. The small signal conductance of a diode is the diode current divided by the thermal voltage, right? Typically, because of this exponential dependence, when you specify the operating point of a bipolar transistor, you specify only the collector current. Okay, in case of MOS transistor, you can specify either VGS or ID and calculate one from the other. In this case, you frequently don't know the value of IS, and this VA exponential is very sharp on nonlinearity. So you simply specify IC, you know that VB is whatever it should be for that value. Okay, and then we have, yeah, it is, yeah. So that's right. We have assumed that the quiescent value VB is 0.7, so that means that we have set IS in some way, right? Yeah, IS of course depends on the transistor parameters, but in hand calculations, calculating anything involving, I mean, even if you have just like one linear term and an exponential, AX plus B exponential of X equals something, you can't solve it, right? So we don't use that at all. Partial derivative with respect to VCE, this will be IS exponential VB by VT times 1 over VA, and we approximate this to the total current. Okay, and this is approximately equal to the total current divided by the early voltage. Okay, again, this is to make it convenient for hand analysis. If you use a simulator, what happens is at every instant, as you apply the signal, each of these quantities IC and VC and VB will be changing, and it will calculate the derivatives at that instant. In our case, we just have to do it at the operating point and use that. Yes? Yeah, you want it to be. So that, I mean, that number is, let's say, much smaller than 1. Yeah. Okay. So if you're operating with the VCE of let's say 1 to 2 volts, and VA happens to be 1 volt, then I think this is a very poor amplifier, right? It has a very high slope. So, but maybe VA is of the order of 10 volts or so at least. So. we have this, and then this is just okay, and this is IC by beta VT, and this is right, and with these four we can construct the small signal model. We have the small signal increment VBE, and we have Y21 times VBE, right? What is Y21? Y21 is okay. Now, just like with the MOS transistor, this quantity is called the GM. GM is Y21, which is IC by VT. IC here refers to the quiescent current of the bipolar transistor. If a transistor is biased at 1 milliamp, what will be the GM? What is the thermal voltage? Thermal voltage? 25 millivolts. So, how much is GM? Yeah, what is that? 40 millisiemens, okay. And we will have an output conductance. How much is that? What is that? What is the expression? Huh? Beta times? No. IC by VA, okay. So, this Y22 is IC by VA, and typically this is denoted by R0, the output conductance of the bipolar transistor, which is 1 by Y22, which is VA by IC. Okay. And on this side we will have Y12 times the incremental VCE. How much is Y12? IC by beta VA, okay, and we also have a conductance Y11. How much is that? IC by beta VT, and again conventionally this its resistance is what is indicated as R pi, and that is beta VT by IC, okay, which is basically 1 by Y11, okay. So, the main difference is that the current in port 1 is not 0 in the incremental circuit. Now, this beta is typically a large number and VA is also a large voltage. So, it is quite, I mean usually in most of the calculations you just neglect this completely, okay. And of course, thankfully it also makes it easier, because if you have interaction both ways from this side to that side and back, you will get these coupled equations. Without that, life is a lot easier, okay. So, you usually neglect Y12 and use an use a model with these three elements: R pi, GM and RO, okay. So, the main difference you can see compared to the MOS transistor is that you will have an input resistance, whereas the small signal input resistance of a MOS transistor is infinite, here it is very much finite, okay. So, that basically brings in some differences in constraints. So, every MOS transistor circuit that you have studied, you can almost every one of them you can turn it into a bipolar transistor circuit. What is different is the constraint that you have to apply, okay. So, you may not be able to choose the values as freely as with a MOS transistor. Is this okay? No, because it is usually a small number, right. I mean VA is a large voltage, beta is a large number, usually hundreds. So, IC by beta VA typically is quite small, okay. Essentially, what is that constant? That constant tells you how much IB is varying because of VCE variations. It does vary, but it is quite small and you can neglect that. Yeah. VA, it is just some constant, it is like lambda in a MOS transistor, okay. So, sometimes this picture is shown. See, you measure the transistor characteristics. In this region, the current won't be flat with VCE. This is IC versus VCE, okay. you find that it has some slope. The slope of that is 1 by VA, that's all, okay. Sorry, the slope of that is IC by VA, whatever the constant current is supposed to be, that divided by VA. Yeah, you can do that, right? I mean, if you assume that this is a straight line and you project it backwards and you will get VA, I mean, that's just another way of saying it's a slope, isn't it? I mean, so if you start with a line with minus VA and then make it intersect IC, some IC naught here, okay, what is the slope of this? IC naught by VA, that's all. So you say that whatever the transistor characteristic is part of this. That's okay. I think those things, those pictures are probably shown, maybe that's the way it is measured and so on. When you had these curve tracers and you had to do it on graph paper, you draw the straight line back and then see what that value is to measure it. Now you can do it in so many ways. Okay. What is early about this? Yeah, it's the name of some guy. It's not earlier than anything. Okay. So now we have the bipolar transistor, and again, because we do everything based on the model, once we have the model, we should be able to do everything that we did before, okay. So let's try to do some of the basic circuits that we started off with, even with whatever circuits we started with using a MOS transistor, let's try to do with bipolar, okay. Now, like I said, there is another type of transistor with everything of reverse polarity. The currents will be backwards and the voltages will be backwards. That's a PNP transistor. I'll come to that later. Okay, so that's the counterpart of the PMOS transistor. So, what's the first thing we did with a MOS transistor? Now, before we could set it up as an amplifier, we had to do something. What was that? Constant VGS biasing. That's correct. So if you want a certain VGS, a quiescent VGS and a quiescent VDS, right? So this is what we did, it will bias, and then of course we also have some signal picture in mind and we combine the two pictures, okay. Now the counterpart of this would be with bipolar transistor. Okay, so this will bias it with a constant, quiescent VBE and VCE, okay. Will this work? Yeah, I mean, if you on paper, it may work. Actually, this you never do, you can't do this, okay. Why is that? Yeah, that's true in the left side also, right? No, I'm not talking about practical difficulties and whether it's nice and all this stuff, whether it will even work. So what happens is that on paper it will work, okay. So there will be some current here and there will be some current here. Now it turns out that, of course, what is the power dissipated in the MOS transistor? VDS times ID, okay. It's actually, if you have an N port, or if you have V1, V2, I1, I2, what's the power dissipated in this device? V1, I1 plus V2, I2, okay. So the point is some power VDS Q times ID is dissipated here. And what is it here? It is the same VC Q times IC plus VBQ times IB, you may even neglect this and so on. So the point is some power is dissipated. As a result of that, the device heats up a little bit, okay. Now what happens to, so if you apply a given VGS to a MOS transistor, right, and then you heat up the device, what do you think will happen to the current? So let's say at room temperature, you set it up with 3 volts VGS, 4 volts VDS, and it's carrying 100 microamperes, and you heat up, what will happen? What happens to the current? It decreases, increases. Why? What resistance? Will be? No, that is not. It will decrease. Why? No, I mean, what is the expression for current in a MOS transistor? Mu times, I mean, you have mu and you have Vt. Okay, what happens to mu when you heat it up? It will fall. Okay, mobility, right? Mobility will fall off. And then what happens to the threshold voltage? It will increase. It will actually decrease, but anyway, the net effect is that ID decreases. Okay. The net effect in a MOS transistor is that if you raise the temperature, the current will reduce. In a bipolar transistor, what happens? I mean, this we discussed a few days back, I think, for a diode, but it'll, what happens? I mean, for a given VB, so just look at this expression, IS exponential VB by VT. IS increases substantially with temperature, okay. The rest of it reduces, but actually this net expression, it increases quite sharply with increase in temperature. So what happens is, the device heats up because of its own power dissipation, and then the current increases, so it heats up some more and so on. So it goes into this electrothermal positive feedback. So if you do this, the transistor will very likely burn out, unless you have some way of keeping it at an absolutely constant temperature. So this kind of biasing, fixed VGS biasing, the counterpart of that fixed VBE biasing, is simply not used with a bipolar transistor. You can't use it, okay. So it will, the device will burn out if you try to do that, okay. So this is gone. In some ways it's good. If you have fewer choices, it's easier to come to the answer, right. So in a bipolar transistor, the only reasonable way of biasing is using negative feedback and at a given collector current, okay. No, that's what I'm saying. So you can't use a fixed VBE. You have to bias it with a fixed collector current. Okay. So that's what we'll have to do. Now, I mean, for the purpose of this discussion, I'll assume beta is infinity and collector and emitter currents are the same. That is, I won't worry about whether the collector current is 1 milliamp or emitter current is 1 milliamp. If the emitter current is 1 milliamp, the collector current is probably 0.99 milliamps. So it's all the same to me. Okay. So biasing, this is ruled out, so we have to use constant current biasing. And how do we do that? I mean, we have four different ways, right? We sense at the drain and feed it to the gate and so on. So we have sense at the collector and feed back to the base. What will this picture look like? This biasing. What do we do? Current source. Current source going to the collector, I naught. Then, yeah. So essentially, what you want is a positive gain amplifier from collector to base. I mean, something that has incremental positive gain, so that when the collector voltage increases, the base voltage must increase. That's what we want. And the easiest realization is to short it. Not the only possible one, but you can have other ones, and the emitter is simply grounded. Okay. What is the value of IC? If beta is infinity, it is I naught. If it is not infinite, yeah. So you can actually, what this does is to set IE to be I naught. This current will be I naught, right? So IC will be beta by 1 plus beta times I naught. Okay. By the way, this constant, it's given another name. It's called alpha. Okay. It's a number very close to 1. Again, when we are doing operating point calculations, we can assume beta to be infinity and alpha to be 1. Okay. So that's fine, unless otherwise mentioned in some problem. Is this okay? So again, the same picture as the MOS case. So quickly we can go through the other possibilities. I want to sense at the emitter and feedback to the emitter. What should I do? I just have a current source here, and I have to connect the base to some fixed voltage VB0, and the collector is not used as far as biasing is concerned. Okay, so this also sets the emitter current to be equal to I0. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, zero is okay. Yeah. I mean, the reason it has to be reverse biased is you don't want any current in the junction, right? With 0 volts also, there will be nothing, isn't it? What happens if you have 0 volts across a junction? That's okay. And actually, like I said, this VCE sat is smaller than VBE on. Just for easy calculations, we assume that it is equal to VBE on. Okay, but we can short it. That's not a problem. Yeah. Was there another question? Where? No, no. There will be very much current in the short. Okay. The base current has to flow here. Okay. The junction is not forward biased in the usual sense. So that's what I meant. Okay. The transistor will draw. I mean, if it has to carry a current IC, it has to carry a base current IC by beta, right? That current will be flowing there. Okay. Resistor where? No, I mean, we can choose to. Right now, our only concern is biasing. Okay. So, what did we do in case of the MOS transistor? To bias it. We did this, right? That's all. All right, I wasn't clear about the question. What is the question? No, no, but isn't this what we did with the MOS transistor? Yes or no? Yeah, we'll do the same. Okay. Now, in some circuits, we also had a resistance here. I mean, that's because we wanted a resistance in the circuit. Okay. So, that we can also do with the bipolar transistor. So, right now, like I said, my only concern is to bias the transistor. After that, depending on what function I use this for, I may have a resistor there, I may not have it. Okay. Yeah, that we have to worry about, how much voltage drop there is, etc. Okay. So, now if we do connect a resistor here, there will be a voltage drop across it. That will, when we get there, we will see how much, I mean, that will maybe limit the value of resistance you can put, or maybe limit the applicability of this particular circuit. Okay. As far as keeping it in active region, it will help. But who knows what else. I mean, if the value of resistor you want is so much that RG could be in mega ohms, so that probably you can't use it. Okay, let me quickly draw the other two. I think if we sense at the collector and feedback to the emitter, what do we need? How do we do this? We need basically some negative gain. That is, the emitter voltage should reduce when the collector voltage increases and so on. And similarly, we can sense at the emitter and feedback to the base. That picture will look like that with I0 over there. Okay. Now, this, as with the MOS, it provides feedback to the emitter as well as to the base. But if you have an amplifier here, the feedback to the base will be much stronger than the feedback to the emitter. Okay. So, we have to use one of these four biasing techniques in every case, and of course, we can also substitute the current source with a resistor and so on. So, that is independent of whether we are using a MOS or bipolar transistors. In fact, it works better with the bipolar transistor. Okay. So, again, the same way as with the MOS. Okay. By the way, we also have what is known as bi-CMOS technology, in which case you could have MOS and bipolar transistors. So, sometimes you could use that. But whatever techniques we use for generating current sources in MOS, we can also try to do them with bipolar. We will see that in the next class. Okay.